it's only when you really go through suffering that you kind of, in a way, that's a real blessing in disguise, because it helps you to really cry, to go beyond yourself, or really cry to see something, to have a deeper experience. And so the challenges that you have, you know, when it's kind of difficult, and then there's a part inside yourself that really, you know, really cries for something, for the capacity to do it, and then you can kind of have real, like, breakthroughs.
Kia ora koutou, that was Harita Davies. I'm Eugene Bingham, and this is Dirt Church Radio. Interesting conversations with interesting runners.
It's easy to make a silly joke about wild things or whatever and be funny about the ads, but at the moment I think one of the things that we are all craving is community, especially because going out into the wild places is something that some of us can't do at the moment, or we're struggling to. Wild Things has been an established community hub for a long time.
It's like a rock.
It's an institution in Aotearoa trail running. If you use the code DCR2021, you'll get 15 months VIP membership for the price of 12. You get access to all the benefits that Wild Things has, their trail challenges, the shops. What am I missing?
Well, even community, just things like the library.
The library.
You know, I look forward to, because I mean, I like reading about running stuff, and I often think, yeah, I've seen everything. But then I'll get the email with all the latest offerings from the Wild Things library, and it's like, huh, I'd missed that. That's a great read. And of course, we're kind enough to include Dirt Church Radio each week, so if you've missed an episode, you'll see it in there. So there's lots of different advantages you get of being a VIP member. And if you use that code, DCR2021, you get 15 months VIP membership for the price of 12.
It's incredible. Please support Rob in his endeavor, and insert silly comment here.
Yeah.
Further Faster has a mega sale. It's written in pink neon writing, all capitals, Friday, October 22nd to Saturday the 30th. So as you're listening to this, they'll be midway through their mega sale. They always go off their sales up to 50% off in store and online. They've got like a sample seconds and odds and sods warehouse space that you can come and have a look. My goodness, which is Friday. So, yes, yeah, it's right through there. So incredible. If I was in Christchurch, I would be getting in there to have a look at what bargains I could snaffle up. I might actually check out the website, which is furtherfaster.co.nz, and do some more online ordering, which is something I'm getting pretty good at the moment. Please, these guys have been with us for the longest time. Again, you know, amazing community. Please support them, furtherfaster.co.nz.
It goes something like, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Oh, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go to further, faster now.
Church Radio.
Episode 166, we made it. I've made it. Eugene here. Matt has been tied up with a work emergency, and we are thinking of you and missing you. I will keep this short and snappy, since it's just me here and you don't want to hear me rambling on to myself. But we're very, very delighted to bring you an amazing conversation this week with Harita Davies, Christchurch-born runner. She just completed the longest foot race in the world, the Sri Chinmoy Self-Transcendence 3,100-mile event in New York. She broke her own New Zealand record in the process, a time of 50 days, 13 hours, 23 minutes and 14 seconds. She was the only woman in the field this year, which she's been that before. It's the third time that she's completed it. Only a few women have completed it three times. It's an astonishing event. Athletes have 52 days to complete 3,100 miles running a block in New York. 3,100 miles for us metrics is 4,989 kilometres, which if you think of that in terms of Aotearoa, that's the equivalent of running from Kaitaia to Bluff, you know, from the top of the North Island to the bottom of the South Island, turning around, running back to Kaitaia, then turning around again to run to Wellington, and then you've still got 107 kilometres to run. Amazing. We talked to Harita about the event itself, how she managed herself through it, how she came into this race with some more knowledge specific to female athletes, and there's some really good information there for female athletes, for women who run. And we also talked to her in depth about the practice of meditation and what it means to her in terms of her running. So you will really, really enjoy this conversation with an amazing athlete and human. Okay, I'll hit this button. Alrighty. Kepler has moved to January 15. The announcement came through last week, just as we were putting the podcast to bed, as it were. So January the 15th is the new event, new date for Kepler. January is packed. Within a week, if you want to, you could do The Revenant, Kepler, Ultra Easy, Naseby, and a bunch of other races. So I guess you better all get training. Yeah, it's, I guess, inevitable with the COVID situation here lingering, particularly in Auckland, Tāmaki, Makaurau. We're going to see more events postponed and so on. So yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how the calendar gets packed for next year, when hopefully, presumably with vaccine certificates, we're going to be able to get back to racing. So keep an eye on that calendar and figure out your training schedule. Oof. Okay, I'll just roll into the racing, which was on this weekend. Hallelujah. Mission Mount Summers was on in Canterbury in the Mount Summers track, on the Mount Summers track, with technical single trail, views of the Canterbury Plains, and basically it's a trail running paradise. And it had some great fields. People were obviously really amped to get racing. In the marathon, Kate Loy, 5:22:38, took out the win. Katie Morgan, 5:25:23, was not far behind. And then Nancy Zhang, 5:41:46, was third. And for the men, Daniel Jones, 4:03:36, romped home. Struan Webb, second, 4:28:02, and Hamish Elliott, 4:35:14, was third. In the 21K, Sabrina Grogan, 2:39:23, Savannah Stewart, 2:41:19, and Miriam Clark, third, in 2:44:53. And for the men, Soares Corporal, 1:56:49, our friend Ryan Carr, 1:58:18, and Ben Williams, 1:59:18, was third. So, yeah, in the 10K too, Sophie Lampe was first in 51:10 for the women, and Callum Brown for the men was the winner in 48:34. And the 5K was Paula Warman, 31:40 for the women, and Ben Guinders, 25:07 for the win there for the men. So, yeah, as I said, amazing fields, right? Some big names there racing, obviously keen to get racing after a long time of no racing. Ruth Croft, we mentioned last week that she was racing in France as we were recording, and of course she bloody went and won, didn't she? Of course. So it was her second win at the Grand Trail des Templiers, an 81k event in southern France with 3,690 metres of climbing. Whew, but mostly runnable terrain. Oh, that's lucky. So she took it easy in the first part of the race and then just took the lead at 35k. I saw an Instagram post from her which she talked about Flight of the Conchords, it's business time coming on. So naturally, she had to step it up. So she did. And just 14Ks later, she was 6 minutes ahead of second place. And then in the final 11K, because she maintained that 6 minute lead for quite a while. And then in the final 11K, she just broke away from the rest of the field and was 20 minutes clear of second by the end. So that's it for her season. What a great season with her second place at Western States. She said it going into the race, it had taken her a while after that to feel back to her usual self after that 100-mile debut. But she drew a lot of confidence from the result. She told Brian Powell from Iron Fire and their coverage that she'll probably be back at Western States next year, so that's going to be exciting. And with a bit more knowledge and experience, watch out. She says that she's due back in Aotearoa. Welcome home if you already are, Ruth. And that she'll do some road races like she did in the build-up this year. So watch the space, eh? The UK's Jonathan Albin won the men's race by 7 minutes. But he put five of those minutes on second place in the last 11K. So he really put the foot down in that last 11K. Okay, I'm going to skip greatest run ever because that's really Matt's special contribution to the show. And so we will delay until next week. But look, keep sending them in. It's a part of the show where we ask you to write in, tell us your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be a race or a mountain summit. It might just be a run around the block, something that's sung to you for some reason. Send it into us, dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. We did have a bit of a COVID backlog, as it were, lockdown backlog, but we've worked our way through that. So keep sending them in. We really love hearing them, and we get a lot of feedback from people saying how much they enjoy that part of the show. So please do send them in. But for this week, we'll get straight into our interview with Harita Davies. As I mentioned, Christchurch born, now lives in New York. Just completed the longest foot race in the world, the Sri Chinmoy Self-Transcendence. Why don't we stumble over that? 3,100-mile event in New York. We followed her progress, didn't we, during the race, and encouraged her and supported her. So it was great to see her finish in such a great time. 50 days, 13 hours, 23 minutes, and 14 seconds. You will get a lot out of this conversation, I'm sure, and we were really, really privileged to be able to catch up with Harita Davies.
Dirtchurch Radio.
Joining us on the line from New York is Harita Davies. Kia ora, Harita, and congratulations.
Kia ora, and thank you so much.
Yeah. How what does recovery even look like after such a mammoth event?
Well, it takes a little bit of time. And now that it's my third time doing it, I can say that it seems that each time I've done it, the recovery definitely seems easier.
Right.
Yeah. The first time I did it, my whole being was in so much shock that it took me even at least a month to be able to sleep at night without dreaming that I was still out on the race course.
Wow.
Yeah. Every night I dreamt that I still had like 5 laps to go or 10 laps to go or something like that. It was really torture.
Wow.
So now, like this time, I don't have dreams like that at all, and I'm actually, even compared to the last time I did it 2 years ago, I'm sleeping a lot better. And ideally, to recover after this race, you want to get a lot of sleep, and you want to eat really well. Sri Chinmoy said eat and drink voraciously afterwards. Don't worry about, you know, gaining weight.
Yeah.
Yeah, eat a lot, drink a lot, rest a lot. And but one of the things that almost seems contrary to what people think is that, especially for the first week after the race, you actually need to keep moving because all of your organs and your whole system is so geared to be working at such a hard pace that if you just stop and sleep, then you can actually even do damage to your kidney and liver and that kind of thing. So
it's like going, you don't want to go cold turkey.
No, you do need to, for your feet and your legs, you really feel it as well. You do need to kind of force yourself to go out and, yeah, ideally do some running. I've been mostly just walking.
Yeah,
and take it easy on yourself.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, well, that's fascinating that it even inveigles your dreams, or it can do. So you said you were happy the race was able to take place because of these, I guess, the extraordinary times that we're in. How good was it being able to come together for a race after all that's happened in the last 18 months plus?
Yeah, it felt so, so you could say indescribably good and special and meaningful. This race is always something that is meaningful because it's something that gives, that's so beyond people's comprehension that it does give people inspiration, and it does, you know, hopefully inspire people to also stretch their own capacity and do more than they can. And so for me, that has a lot of meaning in it. But definitely this year, I felt like even in our little local area in New York and then in the big world family, there's been so much isolation, and so many people have been, you know, unhappy or anxious or worried, and, you know, have just been by themselves. And then there's also been a lot of division in the way that people approach the virus and how they feel about it. And even going into the race, there was a lot of people who felt that the race shouldn't happen this year. It was, you know, not a good idea. It was dangerous. And, you know, what if we all get the virus? And then there was other people who really felt, no, it absolutely has to happen. You know, we need to do it. And I just really felt like I just actually really prayed that if it was meant to happen, it would happen. And if it wasn't meant to happen, it wouldn't happen. And, you know, that was my only way, because I felt like it should happen, but then you never really know, you know, what could happen. So, the fact that it happened, felt very meaningful to me. And I felt that at the end of the race, I was so happy that I felt it really did bring people together and give people joy and inspiration, which is exactly what we need right now, and hope.
Absolutely. It's interesting you're praying for, basically, if it's to happen, it will happen. If it won't, it won't. There's a lesson there, isn't there, in the way that in these past 18 months we've had to learn to almost like try stop controlling the things we can't control. We've been so caught up in what should and shouldn't happen when lots of things are out of our control. How have you coped with that, especially being in New York, which for a long time was at the epicenter of this pandemic?
Yeah, it was. I'm really grateful that I have a spiritual life and that I practice meditation, because that helped me tremendously, because it gives you a basic faith that there is a higher power taking care of everything and that everything will be okay. And also my practice of meditation really gives me the capacity to focus on all of the good things and the things to be grateful for. And I think that that's such a powerful practice for anybody, whether you see yourself as a spiritual person or not, to really try to always focus on the good things in your life and the blessings that you do have. And here in New York, it was very challenging for a long time. And one of the most challenging things for me was that I am by nature an optimistic person, and I like to focus on all of the positive sides. And when I saw a lot of my friends and people around me having so much anxiety and feeling like their lives were just falling apart, I found that hard to deal with, because I felt like definitely in our community, with the people that I live with, we all had enough food. We were all in our houses, internet, you know, there was nothing apart from the fact that you could get the virus. As long as you didn't have it, really your life was so comfortable compared to what so many other people in other neighborhoods of New York or around the world are facing. And so for me, that was a big challenge, to not judge those people and to accept that if people have anxiety and stress, then that's their nature, and you can't change that, in the same way that they can't make me be really anxious and worried about getting the virus. I can't make them stop being anxious and worried. And so in so many ways, there's these, you can say, opportunities to to be a bigger person and to grow and to not judge other people, and also just to in the end to be so grateful for what we do have. I guess now in New York, it's interesting compared to New Zealand. You know, now we've sort of been through the whole thing, and although there are still a lot of cases and people are still getting the virus, we're really in a completely different place from where New Zealand is at now. So that's really, really interesting. And at the same time, there are still people here who are very concerned and worried, but overall we went through a lot together as a city and as a country, going through the whole election and everything at the same time. And I do feel that there is, although it has divided people, it still gives us a kind of strength and and forward movement when we feel that although we're not at the end of it, we've definitely gone through a lot and we're coming out the other side, which is something positive.
We spoke to a guest recently, Andy Jones Wilkins, who described it as we have to remember we're in an ultra marathon here. This is not a sprint, you know, and there are going to be highs and lows, and we just need to be in that mindset as we go through this. But anyway, on the race itself, you were the only female in the field. Was that significant to you?
Well, it's the second time that's happened to me. First time I did the race, there were four women. The second time, up until close to the race, there were going to be two other women, and then they both pulled out because of injuries. So I was the only woman. And then this year, even going into the race, there were no other women who were, you know, in a position to do it. And so it's something that I kind of was used to from last time. And also this, the nature of this race is not that you're kind of out on your own with these six other guys for 52 days. Like, it is a half mile loop. And so every 8 to 10 minutes, I would see a bunch of other women. So, and I had a really great team of women helpers and friends and supporters, since I, you know, at the moment I live in this local area. So I definitely wasn't lacking in woman power being around me. But at the same time, I definitely felt, I guess I felt, in one sense, it's nice you feel all of the women in the world behind you, because, you know, they want you to do well. So that's nice. And then there's a certain kind of responsibility to, you know, to feel like you really want to do well for, you know, for the for womankind. And and then it was at the same time in this race, it's such a family feeling, and although it's a race and it is a competition, at the same time it's really like a little community, and all of the runners really are like your brothers, and we really have a family feeling where we try to help each other and be supportive of each other. And so in a very nice way. So the other guys who were doing it really were like brothers, and that was a nice experience. Yeah, I think some of the runners that do this race are really some of the best representatives of men in the world, because they've gone through so much, and many of them have done it many times, and they have so much humility and kindness and goodness, and there's ultra running beats down the ego, you could say.
It sure does, especially an event like that, I imagine. Oh, that's a lovely way to describe it, like running with brothers. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it did seem, in watching some of the video feed and so on, that there was, it's a very, very special event, isn't it? And, you know, having watched coverage of it over the years, it's something quite amazing. How do you even describe what it's like to be amongst that and in that environment, and how it's much more than just a running event?
Well, I guess it's such a huge thing to describe, but it's like a little world in itself, and it's very powerful. One of the things is the circular nature of the race. I've kind of mentioned in other interviews that at one point one of my friends pointed out that everything in the world is going around in small circles, you know, right from the atoms inside our body to the, you know, the earth rotating around the sun every day, and the moon going around, and all of the planets in the universe, and, you know, everything's actually going around in circles. And so people say it's such an unusual concept, but it's not actually unusual at all. It's actually completely natural. But then it does it does create an energy and a power when you're just all going around and around the same, you know, the same small course. And that's something that everybody feels, I think.
Yeah. And you draw from that, I guess, being part of it. You're giving to that spirit, you're giving to that environment, but you're also drawing strength from it, I imagine.
Yeah, definitely.
On your performance itself, in breaking your record by almost a whole day, how much stock do you put in that aspect of it, the performance aspect of it? And was it something you realized you were capable of before the race?
Yeah, so for me, doing the race is not, it's not about, you know, trying to smash records or whatever, but at the same time, it is called the Self-Transcendence 3100 Mile Race, and the whole foundation of the race is a self-transcendence experience. And so if you can have the, you know, having the outer goal, having the goal of 3100 miles, having the amount of miles you have to do every day, having these kind of goals is what you know, motivates you to keep going and what keeps you going. And so then when you feel like you can do better than your previous time, then obviously that's a motivating factor, and it gives you the feeling that you're transcending yourself outwardly. And then in order to transcend yourself outwardly, you have to go beyond, you know, your mind's limitations and yeah, your preconceived ideas of what you can do. And there's certain, I think most people who are runners know that every time you do faster than you've done before, or you do better in a race, then there's a certain level of something. You have to do something better, you know, to do that. You have to either you have to practice more meditation, practice more mind control, you have to do more train, you know, sprint training or strength training or that kind of thing. And so I definitely did, I learned about Stacey Sims, who, you know, has written a lot about the difference between women athletes and male athletes. And that gave me, like, you know, a few good pointers on things that, that it's important for me to do differently, particularly in the heat and when it's, you know, when you're dealing with your monthly cycle. And that's something really different when you're the only woman in a race, then, the other men don't have to worry about those kind of things. So that I found that really helpful. And then I also did more strength training this year than I've done before in my training, and that was helpful. So I knew going into the race that I was stronger than I had been before, and that I kind of had more, I knew more outwardly than I did before. You know, you could say outwardly compared to like the inner realm of your spirituality. And then, you know, then inwardly, I feel like with my practice of meditation, with my spiritual life, with, you know, always trying to kind of progress and go beyond myself, that definitely the last couple of years has been a big challenge. And I really hope that I've grown as a person and that I could take that strength into the race and yeah, remind myself that I was doing it for all of humanity and that I had the whole world behind me as well. And yeah, so I think all of those things, you know, came together for me. Mm, yeah.
Mm. Wow, that's so exciting. Can you talk a bit more about the Stacey Sims work and what it was that you took from it and how that was able to help you, in as far as it's able to help other women runners.
So because this race was held in the fall, we didn't have to deal so much with hot weather. Previously, it's always been held in summer, and there's definitely a difference in how women cope with the heat and with hydration at different stages of their cycle. And so the first half of the race in September, sometimes we did have some quite hot weather. So when you're in the second part of your cycle leading up to getting your period, then women, actually their blood becomes kind of a little thicker, so they need to actually hydrate more, and their body temperature rises slightly, so they it's harder to hydrate, and they need to drink more and take more electrolytes actually than men do. So that was something really helpful to know, just to be, you know, to be really aware of the hydration and of the fact that you have to, there's more things you can do to help you to cool your body down and to deal with the heat. And then yeah, eating more protein and less carbohydrates. And women in general have a lot more trouble with their stomachs than men do. I think men often have trouble with their stomachs, but for women in ultra running, every woman that you speak to who does multi-day races is like, oh, the, you know, the stomach problems are really the worst part of it. And I can't say that I can't say that I really managed to get over that one. Like, definitely in the last couple of weeks of this race, my stomach was really my biggest challenge. So I've definitely still got progress to make in that field. I mean, it's difficult on anybody's stomachs, but yeah, from my observation, the men compared to the women have a lot more trouble with their stomachs. So having less sugar, having, you know, eating really whole foods, which is something that we tend to do in this race anyway, compared to other shorter races where people might have lots of gels and things, which can really wreak havoc on your stomach. But knowing about that and knowing the difference between men and women, and that women are more sensitive, I think gave me a lot of confidence. And then really knowing the importance of strength and of being strong, building up my muscle mass before the race, and knowing that that would that's something that's really important for women to do, just kind of gave me confidence as well. And yeah, that's a few things, but I think one of the key things that I took away from reading Stacey Sims' book and actually doing her course was just kind of giving me the confidence that you don't have to feel like you're going to fall apart when you get your period during the race, and that there are things that you can do and that you can stay strong, and that that women have the capacity to they scientifically, you know, as well as through, you know, their mental capacity, have the capacity to do these kind of things.
And we see so many great examples, don't we, of incredible ultra runners.
We do, and we're seeing it more and more, which has been so, so exciting. And I think that, I'm happy to be, you know, to be able to be an example and an inspiration, and hopefully, because the more women that you see doing these things and, you know, even outright winning ultra races, more confidence it will give to other women as well. So that's why I'm, you know, so that really inspires me, and it really inspires me to get on top of these things that are obstacles for other women, so that I can show that it's that we can do it.
I while we're on this topic, I read that you had significant issues with endometriosis, is that right? That actually stopped you from running for a long time. Do you mind, in that same way as to how it might help other people, do you mind talking a little bit about what that process was and how you were able to navigate your way through it, I guess, to get back to running the incredible distances that you do now?
Yeah, well, for me, I always had a lot of trouble with really bad period pain, and as a lot of women do, and it's something that, you know, up until recently women don't speak about at all. And this would be like, you know, a huge issue if I was running a marathon or something, and, you know, it came at the same time. At one point in my life, after I had done a multi-day race, I did 3 6-day races and 1 10-day race. And after I did a race in 2007, I think I didn't really look after myself properly afterwards. I didn't really recover properly, and I just kind of went downhill. And then I developed I think I already had endometriosis, but it became more serious. And then for almost 5 years, I really couldn't run more than about 2 miles without getting really exhausted. And I would get a lot of like internal kind of inflammation. And so I actually Sri Chinmoy passed away in 2007, but I actually asked him about it before he passed away, because he would always be happy to take questions from us. And I asked him, you know, if I should. I had been advised by an Ayurvedic doctor that I should give up running, and I really didn't want to give up running. So I asked him about it, and he said to me, no running for 3 months, then run and walk, then run. And then he passed away less than a month later, actually, after he had given me that advice. And so I didn't run for 3 months, and then the run and walk phase ended up being like 5 years. But at the same time, I was so grateful that I had asked him that, because I really felt that he saw that I would be able to start running again. Like, he definitely didn't say don't run anymore. And so I felt like, even though it went for a long time, I felt like at some point I'm going to be able to start running again. So I had that faith in my spiritual teacher and in my spiritual life. And even though I thought the period would be a lot shorter, in 2011, we were, you know, we had the big earthquake in Christchurch, and the restaurant that I worked at was the Lotus Heart that was closed down. You know, it was where both of our locations were damaged in the earthquake. And so I ended up going and spending some time in New York. And then I never, ever imagined living in New York, because I really love New Zealand. And, you know, I always totally see myself as a New Zealander. But, yeah, I just inwardly kind of saw that it was time for me to have a change in my life, and that there were things about the way that I was living my life that just weren't making me happy, and that I really needed to be happy to be able to be healthy. And so I ended up getting really involved in the Peace Run, and the Sri Chinmoy Oneness Home Peace Run is like kind of another big vision of Sri Chinmoy's for peace in the world. Everything that he did was kind of aimed at the individual contribution to worldwide peace, and that each one of us ultimately are the ones who are going to bring peace to the world. And so in 2012, I did the American Peace Run, like 3 months of it. And that involved a lot of running. And that was something I just got inspired to do. But at the same time, I was really nervous because I didn't know if I'd be able to do the running, but it was also making me really happy. And so for me, just taking responsibility for my own happiness, kind of being brave to make some big life changes and to do something different and to kind of follow my heart and my inspiration was really a catalyst to physical healing. And so after that, yeah, I never really looked back. And even though I tried to, I came back to live in New Zealand, but it just like, not because of New Zealand, but just because I was meant to do something different. And then I ended up, now I'm one of the directors of the American Peace Run. And so that's like something that I'm really passionate about. And through doing that and just kind of taking responsibility for my happiness and listening to my heart and being really true to myself, the endometriosis really just went away. So I was, I can't say that would be like a magic cure for everyone, but Sri Chinmoy has a really simple little aphorism that says, a cheerful mind has always been a perfect guide to a healthy body. And sometimes the most simplest, you know, phrases can have the most power. And I think there really is a lot in that. And I've seen that in myself, and I've seen that in friends and people that I know over and over again, that that we have to, if we really want to be healthy, and if we are struggling with health issues, that it can be complicated. There's so many different reasons for people to have health issues. But for a start, really being sincere with yourself about, are you really happy, or what changes can you make to be happy, to be fulfilled, can make a huge difference.
Mm. I mean, we know, don't we, that stress can have an enormous impact on our body. So if we're doing things that are making us unhappy, yeah, no doubt that brings stress to the body. And, you know, yeah, so if you can deal with that, I guess there's a path to dealing with the health issues. Mm. You don't have to move to New York, though.
But also, I took so many different vitamins and supplements and all these kind of things. So often we just taking all these pills that aren't helping us at all. You know, if you really meditate or self-reflect or really look at yourself, you can, you know, usually you kind of know whether it's an unhealthy relationship or what it is, you know, that there's something in your life that's really not working. Mm. Yeah.
Mm. Thank you for sharing that. On the race itself, again, I keep coming back to it, don't I? But how did you manage yourself day to day? Again, there's the act of tying up your shoelaces, but it's much more than that, isn't it? To be able to get to the race line, to start line every day. And that involves what you do at night as well. So I wonder if you'd just talk us through how you did manage to manage yourself for so many days on end.
Sure. So I was really fortunate. I had a team of helpers, and I had actually three main people, because it's a huge, the race happens for 18 hours, but then there's before and after. So it's pretty much like about 20 hours a day that you kind of are are active. And so I had somebody who would help me get out the door in the morning. So I can kind of say from the start of the day, if you like I would.
Sure, yeah. Race.
So I live actually really close to the race course in Jamaica, Queens. So I was able to stay in my own house, although my bedroom is in the attic. And so I moved down to the ground floor of the house so I didn't have to walk up all those stairs every day. So, yeah, my alarm would go off at 5:15, then I'd usually, and then I would go off again at 5:20, then I would kind of drag myself out of bed. And usually you just like have like a 5-minute meditation. Usually I would meditate for a lot longer, but just, you know, obviously during the race, just a really short meditation. Usually when we're doing the race, we take it as part of our meditation, you know. So and right from the start of the day, just try to see the bright side of it. And because if your mind is just kind of like, oh god, torture, I have to get up everything hurts, so you kind of just, for me, one of my main ways of coping is almost just to kind of laugh at myself, just kind of wake up and be like, oh my god, here I go again, you know. Just kind of like, all right, I know this is outrageous, but you know, we're gonna do this, you know. And we're gonna just take the first step. And a long time ago in my life, I kind of learned that you just need to break things down into small steps. Even like, I worked at a restaurant for so many years where I used to work really, really long hours. And if you thought of the whole day, it would just be too much. But if you just thought, okay, I'm just going to make the muffins, I'm going to start with that, then I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, then, you know, you can cope with it. It's like always finding ways to kind of trick your mind or to help your mind cope with it. So yeah, you just kind of think, okay, I've just got to get myself to the start line. Like, that's all I need to focus on. Brush my teeth, put on my shorts and t-shirt. Someone would 10 to 6, someone would come and give me a ride to the race. I had actually 7 different women who would come and pick me up each morning. So, you know, different friends of mine. So it's about a 3 or 4 minute drive to the race. So someone would give me a ride there. And I was always the last one to arrive. I'd arrive at like 5 or 6 and everyone else was already there. And then, yeah, then I just basically had to put on my shoes. I would always wear these kind of flip-flop kind of shoes that are quite good for your feet, so that I only wore my running shoes when I absolutely had to, because I also, before the race, I gave a lot of attention to my feet. And I actually saw a woman in Christchurch, her name is Hazel something. She's a physiotherapist who does really alternative kind of treatment. And so she had given me a lot of help, which I forgot to mention earlier, on helping to try to correct the endless problems that I have in my body, that we all have, you know, my uneven hips and my feet and everything. So anyway, that's a side note, but I gave a lot of importance to my feet. And that helped me a lot, strengthening them. Basically I'd get to the race, put on my shoes, and my friend would have made me a smoothie, like, and so I would have that on the first lap. And then we stand on the start line, and I don't know if you saw, you know, that was on the webcam, a lot of people would watch the start of the race, which was kind of an amusing thing, because some people would be staggering to the start, and then, you know, and then we're all just kind of standing there. And again, when you're standing on the start line, you don't think you're going to be running for 18 hours, you know. There's no way that you think that. You just think either of one lap or of a couple of laps, or at the most you think of just between the breaks that you have. So I would have 3 breaks a day. I'd have one break at 10:30, one at 3, and one at 7:30. And so basically my only goal was to at the start of the race, just to make it around the first lap, really, you know. And then as after I've been going for an hour or two, then my main goal would just be to make it to my first break time at 10:30. And usually for the first about the first hour of the race, I would really take that as my meditation time, and I would just try to really silence my mind and just breathe in peace. And focus. I have some songs and prayers that I say every day, so I would do those. And just really, yeah, I didn't want to talk too much or anything, just try to be really meditative and try to be peaceful. And it was always dark, which was kind of nice. One nice thing about having the race in the fall was that we started in the dark, and we saw the whole dawn, the whole sunrise, and then we would see the whole sunset, and then the last few hours would be in the dark. I was always pretty slow at the start of the day. Some people would like run off madly, and I'm not one of those kind of people. I would start walking and then gradually speed up. And then throughout the day, when it's hot, when the sun's out, I actually don't run that well. Like, I find it quite hard to run, even though it wasn't that hot. Like, and the daytime is not my best time for running. Actually, really the only time I run well is after the sun sets. So a lot of the time I would just sort of be, you know, outwardly struggling. So I would have to always be trying to kind of focus on my heart and focus on the simple things that would give me joy. And always you have to kind of try to go beyond the mind, because the mind always wants to tell you how difficult it is, how ridiculous it is. The mind always wants to find the things to get really annoyed and upset about, and to complain about, and all the things that are sore. And there's always, in this race, there's always something hurting. There's always something. Like, you never have a time when there's not something. It's, you know, it's either your left knee or your Achilles or your, you know, right toe, or there's something that's always hurts. And the more you focus on it, the more the sorer it gets. So it's amazing how sore something can get if you really focus on it. It can get really, really painful. So, yeah, one thing is taking your mind off it, or trying to bring light into it, but mostly taking your mind off it and having faith that things come and things go. You know, injuries come, injuries go, pain comes and pain goes. Yeah. But in terms of the overall day, then I would have, I had helpers who were giving me food and drinks.
What were you eating and drinking? Sorry.
Well, I'm vegetarian, uh-huh. So I don't eat any meat, and, you know, all the food that was supplied was also vegetarian. So I was drinking mostly coconut water, actually. That's the main electrolyte that I like to have, but I have it really watered down. So right. Like half coconut water, half water, or even less than that. And then I would drink different kind of herbal teas. I drink kombucha, juices, like green juices, smoothies, you know, quite a few smoothies, non-alcoholic beer sometimes. I don't drink alcohol, but I don't know if people would drink alcohol during a race like that. Maybe they would, I don't know. I don't know. I probably a lot of other things, but my main elite, and then sometimes I would drink like the noon and endurance electrolyte drink if I wanted something different. But for me, and then at the end, I started drinking a lot of it. It was a mixture of baking soda, salt, and maple syrup, because my stomach was so acidic and there was just nothing I could do about it. And so baking soda became my best friend. Actually, I was like really, really laughing, saying that at the end of the race, I was going to approach baking soda companies for sponsorship. I could be the face of baking soda. I use baking soda for this race.
Baking soda's move into the ultra running world.
And I would soak my feet in baking soda at night. We would clean the bath with baking soda. I would be drinking baking soda, but that is actually, it really is a miracle for an acidic stomach. So and that drink can work quite well also as an electrolyte drink. So yeah, that, I guess that sort of overtook coconut water as my main
source.
It doesn't really taste that good, but
the maple syrup would help, I'm sure. So in terms of food, you're eating real food, and were you eating like every lap, or how do you manage that? Was it just during the breaks, or?
No, I'd be eating just small amounts really regularly.
Yeah.
Because also, in one sense, it's good for your stomach because it's you can keep, you're not eating a huge meal and then trying to run on it. It is over time really challenging on your stomach to be eating all the time. And ice cream is something that everybody loves and can eat. But I would, yeah, so I would start the day with a smoothie, like either a green smoothie or like a chocolate maca kind of smoothie. Then I would have oatmeal, some kind of oatmeal. Then I would have eggs and potatoes. And I would have like a yogurt with chawanprash kind of mixture. And yeah, all of that was sort of breakfast, and then move on to different, like we had cooks who would make like different kinds of vegetables, and then all kinds of lunches. And because we had a couple of Asian runners, then we had they liked getting Chinese food, and I actually ended up finding Chinese food really good, like rice and vegetables with tofu, like it was actually quite digestible. So I had a lot of rice. I kind of got pretty into Chinese food, which is good because it's kind of simple. Yeah, rice, you know, try to eat as many vegetables, potatoes, then try to get protein through mostly through smoothies and eggs, and then sometimes beans can be like a little dodgy. Definitely mostly whole foods. And there was a lot of really awesome food that was made for us that I couldn't eat, which was very sad.
Takeaway packs that you put in the freezer.
Yeah, people say, wow, it's so cool, you guys can just eat whatever you want and you still lose weight. And you're like, well, you really can't because your stomach is so upset. So I had a lot of in the evenings, basically after the sunset, it was really hard to digest anything. So I would just have like chia porridge and rice pudding pretty much like for the whole evening. So I consumed huge amounts of chia porridge and rice pudding, that my friends would make for me. And that worked well for me. Soups as well, vegetable soups, miso soup. That's kind of really good. Yeah. But I still, I still ended up losing 22 pounds.
Right.
I don't know how much
of this 10 kilos. I don't know what the calculation is, but yeah, it's, yeah. Wow.
About 10 kilos.
Mm. And at the end of the day, so would you have a mile target for each day, or would you run to the end of the day, or how did you do that?
Yeah, I would always run until midnight pretty much. And so for us, the minimum to finish the race is say 59 miles, which is like 96 kilometers or something. But for us, everything is in laps. So 109 laps is like the kind of target minimum amount of laps. 110 is a little better than like the guy who was winning it, Andrea. He was doing 130 laps a day or something like that. So if I could do 110, 111, 112 laps a day, then I was really happy with that. And that was a huge goal to achieve that for me every day. Like I would basically by my first break at 10:30, I'd try to do about 30 laps. Then by my second break at 3 o'clock, I would try to have done like 57 laps, something like that. But at the same time, I wouldn't like prolong it too long if I hadn't done the amount of laps that I needed. I would really try to have my breaks kind of at that time or a little after. Then I would have by my third break, which was at 7:30, I would try to do over 80 laps. And then always I would have to do so many more laps in the evening to make it up. But for me, the evening was really just my best time for running. It's not like that for everybody. Some people really run much better in the day, and at nighttime they're just kind of dragging themselves around the course. But for me, for whatever reason, I like when the sun goes down and it becomes dark, the course is also transformed because the course has a lot of people, a lot of activity during the day. And then at nighttime, it kind of becomes like more sacred. You could say it's much like kind of quieter. And I think people, probably other people who do ultra marathons, would kind of know that experience as well of the day. When it's the nighttime, it's just a really different kind of feeling. And it was also much more of a meditative time for me. I could just run and kind of pray and meditate and just really try to feel peace, and I felt like I was faster and everything was smoother and easier. And then I would just try to get in as many laps as I can in the last hour. There was always a lot of energy in the last hour, which seems outrageous after you've been running for 17 hours at the last, but it was kind of, it's not a real physical experience. It's such a spiritual experience. And somehow the last hour would have a lot of energy. So I could run probably my most miles of any hour at that time.
Wow. Wow. That says a lot, doesn't it? You mentioned the neighborhood there, and I've always been curious, how do the neighbors react to you running around and around their neighborhood?
They actually love it. Yep. Yeah, I would say most people really love it. It's a very multicultural neighborhood. And so it's become increasingly Bengali. And so there's a huge Muslim population in that area. And a lot of the Muslim people, they come out and they walk or run around the course because it's around a school and a field. Mm. There's a big sport field and there's a playground and there's handball courts and basketball courts at one end, and then there's the Thomas Edison High School at the other end, and there's a big sports field in the middle. So there's no houses in that block.
Yeah.
And there's no streets either that you need to cross or anything. Yeah. So other people do their daily walking or running or exercising around there. And so you get to know a lot of the people. Mm. And yes, there's been some of the Muslim women who have actually started running with me, but they would, they would really appreciate it. And a lot of the people, they show a lot of interest, and they come out and they're cheering you on, and they're generally sad when the race is finishing. Yeah. They're like, I can't believe it's finishing. And I'm like, I can. But then this year we had the unique situation unique from other years, where the school was actually in session, because usually the race is in the middle of summer, and there's usually about 1 or 2 weeks where before school finishes, and then the whole summer there's just summer school, which is a really small amount of students. But this year there must be maybe 700 or 800 students in the school. I'm not actually sure how many. There's a lot. So they would all be arriving at school early in the morning. There'll be 2 sessions of arriving, and then leaving from school, and 2 big sessions in the afternoon. So that was hundreds and hundreds of kids who have really very little interest in you as a runner running around that course. And so, I was thinking about that you think that they have no interest, but I think actually they're teenagers, and they do, but they don't show it.
They don't want to show it. Yeah.
They don't want to show it, but they are actually, like, when people started finishing, when they saw the balloons up, but, a lot of the kids were like, whoa, someone's finishing, like, crazy. So I think a lot of them were interested, but when you're when they come out of school and you're going around and you have to be going against the current of the kids, they are not interested in you at all. That was also one of those things where you can't even slightly let yourself get annoyed with it, because that would just be ridiculous,
right?
You just have to be like, okay, here's the kids, cool.
It's
gonna be fun. Let's see if I can manage to get through them all without getting tripped up, because sometimes their backpack will bash into you. You're trying to go around them and you'll like trip on a tree root and nearly fall over.
It's like two worlds collide, really. Sort of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So all of us would just really try to see it as, something really funny, and just kind of like, okay, here come the kids. Awesome. Can't wait for that.
Oh, wow.
And also, it's all of these things do distract you from your own problems as well. So any kind of distraction.
Something else to think about than your Achilles or your dodgy knee or whatever, or your stomach problems.
Exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you mind telling us about the discovery of your spiritual life and how that came about and what it's meant to you?
Sure. So I was 20 years old, I guess. I'm from Christchurch. I moved to Wellington to do my third year of university in Wellington, for kind of really spontaneously. And I didn't know that the Sri Chinmoy Centre had very recently opened up in Wellington, like right before I moved there. And I had only been there for about 3 days when I saw a poster advertising free meditation workshops and I always thought meditation sounded really boring. I think now, this was 26 years ago, so now people have more understanding of meditation, hopefully, but it looked really boring to me. But at the same time, I was kind of desperate because I really couldn't see how I was going to survive in the world just with what the world was presenting me, and I was pretty disillusioned. I had really lost hope for humanity, and I just didn't know how I was going to be satisfied just getting a job and a house and having kids or whatever, you know, whatever I could see that was, you know, was being presented to me. And so I thought, well, I'll give it a go, and I went along to a free meditation class, and I really liked it. I was really intrigued by the concept of a spiritual teacher. I'd never heard of spiritual teachers before, and I was a pretty staunch feminist at that time, so I was pretty suspicious of having a male teacher. But then I thought, well, at the same time, I really liked the energy of the people and of the place. And I was also really, when I saw the photo of Sri Chinmoy, I thought, oh, you know, these kind of people are always, they're always dead. They're always from the past. And then when I heard that he was alive, I was like, wow, okay, that's kind of interesting, you know? So I was intrigued by that. And I just, it gave me a lot of kind of new avenues to pursue. And so I kept going along to the meditation classes, and I really identified with Sri Chinmoy's philosophy of hope. And that was something that really resonated with me, because I had really lost hope in humanity. And he was 100% convinced that there will be peace in the world, that people are good. And that was how I felt when I was a kid, you know, and it was something that I really wanted to feel. And when I saw that, when I saw that meditation can give you the capacity to really have that hope really sincerely, then I was like, that's what I want, you know. And also, I was in my third year of university, I was doing a BA, and from my experience at university, I was just being presented with a whole lot of different theories and no real answers to what life was about. And I really wanted answers to what the point of life was. And when I read Sri Chinmoy's books, it just gave such clear answers. It's like a direction forward, you know, that there's this ultimate goal of God realization or self-realization, or, you know, complete connection with the higher self, that we all have God, or, you know, the source of divinity within ourselves, and that the goal of life is for us to really uncover all of these layers that prevent us from seeing this part of ourselves, to ultimately become one with it. And whether you believe in reincarnation or not, it kind of became pretty obvious that it's not going to just be a goal that you'll achieve in one lifetime, and that you can come back again and again, but you can, you know, each time you'll make progress, and that if you consciously practice meditation and practice spirituality, then it will really expedite your journey, and that self-transcendence and going beyond yourself and connecting with your higher self are all intrinsically linked. And so I really identified with that. And also, I had, ever since I was a kid, I really wanted to do something that would help the world to be a better place. I'm an Aquarian. I was always humanitarian minded, and I wanted to be able to do something for humanity. And then I really connected with the fact that part of Sri Chinmoy's philosophy is that to help, you know, if you want peace in the world, first you have to have peace inside yourself. And if you want to be able to make the world a better place, you have to, you know, you have to be the best person that you are. And that the world is made up of individual people. And so, you know, one of our greatest contributions to the world is by first really work on perfecting ourselves and being the best version of ourselves that we can be. And so I thought, wow, like I can really, you know, help the world by being a better person myself. And as part of Sri Chinmoy's philosophy, we give a lot of free meditation workshops, and then I moved to Christchurch and we opened the Lotus Heart restaurant, which is a an incredible opportunity to be able to provide a place where people can come and eat food that's cooked with love and to be in a peaceful environment. And I could see how that really added something really meaningful to people's lives. And then I was always drawn to sport. I was always involved with sport ever since I was a kid. My parents were surf lifesavers, and I grew up in the surf lifesaving world, and doing water polo was also my main sport. And as a teenager, when I struggled with depression and all these kind of things, then I really felt sport saved my life, you know, because I would be so depressed and I'd have to crawl out of bed to go to a water polo game, and then I would forget all my problems and be, you know, playing sport. So I knew how much sport had helped me. So I was really interested, and that also really resonated with me that Sri Chinmoy gave so much importance to the connection between spirituality and, you know, physical fitness and sport. And so, yeah, I started running, you know, as soon as I started meditating, really. You know, he talked a lot about the inner running and the outer running, and he encouraged any sport that you get joy from, but he found particularly that running was so symbolic to the spiritual life and the inner journey that we have. And so I really saw how much my running helped my meditation, and my meditation helped my running. So I started doing that, and they were always really linked right from when I started meditation.
Right, because I guess for some people, meditation and peacefulness and so on is almost the complete opposite of what you might go through as a runner. They might see it that way, that, you know, running equals pain and struggle and so on, and meditation is peaceful and you know, finding something outside. But you've always found that they fit together. They sit together. Is that right?
Yeah, perfectly. Yes, yes. And I think a lot of people, even though they might say running is pain or whatever, a lot of people take their practice of running kind of as their meditation. Yeah. You know, they practice meditation. It's still, it's their time when they get out and they, like, when you run, you can really get rid of so much of depression or worries or anxieties or stress or anger, all these things. If you just go out and run hard, you can really get rid of all these things. And that's like, and that's an active form of meditation, because meditation is about like clearing out, you know, all of these kind of heavy things to really access the higher parts of ourselves who we ultimately are, you know, this higher being which is full of light and peace and tranquility. But to access this part of ourselves, we have to go beyond all of the kind of turmoil that our mind creates.
So they fit together and they complement each other in a way.
They really complement each other. And I think a lot of people through running do become interested in meditation. For me, because my running was really inspired by my meditation, then I felt, even when I first did like a marathon, and then when I did my first 60K race like years and years ago, I saw other people go out hard and then kind of die halfway through, and I saw like, oh wow, I'm really lucky that I have my practice of meditation, because I can kind of keep going because I'm not, yeah, just dependent on my outer capacity. But I have some faith that within me that I have, you know, just the power of the power of divine qualities over the mind, and that the mind is so limited. And this is so important for meditation, to go beyond the mind. And that's why Sri Chinmoy really recommends meditation on the heart center, because the heart has all of the peace and light and happiness, and the mind is kind of is so limited, whereas everything unlimited comes from the heart and from within. And so that's an intrinsic part of the philosophy of being able to run the 3,100 mile race, and without it being just like a brutal struggle with your mind, you know.
Yeah.
To really, you know, he said that when you're doing the race, you should try to feel like you're a 7-year-old child running in the garden, you know, kind of just like, which, you know, sounds like ridiculous, but if you can actually really try to bring forward that childlike part of yourself and just like really simplify everything. And running does, when you run for days and days, it really simplifies your mind also, and you naturally see a lot more beauty in everything. And so you look at the sky and you're like, wow, it's so beautiful. You look at like a little child and their face just looks so beautiful. It can give you so much energy and, you know, newness. And that's because you're identifying with your heart. You're not identifying with the limitations and the brutal outlook of the mind.
Yeah. I had an experience recently during our lockdown that we're in several months ago when I was running, so I'm training for a 24-hour race, and I was running around a 200-meter loop at a local park up the road, and I was several hours into it, and it was sort of a drudge and, you know, feeling a bit sorry for myself. And I changed direction, and for some reason I looked up and I saw some hills in the distance that I must have seen, you know, I don't know, countless times. But for some reason it just – I saw it through different eyes, and it just gave me a boost and a lift. It was kind of was it the exhaustion? Was it the sort of place that I'd got myself to, you know, being frustrated and so on. But you mentioned seeing the sky and thinking that's beautiful. It was the same sort of experience of, wow, you know, I've never looked at it like that. And that's only through running that I saw it that way.
Right.
Yeah. So I kind of I hear what you're saying.
Right. And one of the runners, he kind of pointed out that it's only when you really go through suffering that you kind of, in a way, that's a real blessing in disguise, because it helps you to really cry, to go beyond yourself, or really cry to see something, to have a deeper experience. And so the challenges that you have, you know, when it's kind of difficult, and then there's a part inside yourself that really, you know, really cries for something, for the capacity to do it. And then you can kind of have real like breakthroughs, and often the real breakthroughs, like your experience, it's not like the sky parts and angels come down or whatever.
Yeah.
It's just something, it's just like a simple mind shift that completely takes you out of that kind of negative mind and helps you to see everything in a different way and realize that at every moment in life, it's all about our attitude, really. You know, the way that we perceive it and how we look at it. And so you could look at running this race as being like absolute torture, you know. But then you could look at it as an incredible opportunity to access a deeper part of yourself that you normally never have, you know, you can just kind of roll through life and in the way that our lives are so easy, and you don't have a need to. But once you actually are forced to, then you discover so much more capacity within yourself and so much more depth within yourself than, you know, then in your day-to-day life you realize. And then that's such a beautiful experience, because the more, you can't really see beautiful qualities in other people unless you can see them in yourself. So the more that you can see divine qualities in yourself or recognize them, then the more you can also recognize them in other people. And then you can just see life in a completely different way, and it can give you so much love for humanity, so much hope for humanity, and so much hope for your own life just by a mental shift, really, you know.
Yeah, it doesn't have, like you say, it doesn't have to be angels from heaven. Look, we've kept you for such a long time. Thank you so, so much for your time and for this conversation. There is one more question that we always ask everyone who comes on Dirt Church Radio, and that's, what is your greatest run ever? It doesn't have to be a race. It doesn't have to be anything significant, but one run that you think of and think, wow, that was significant to me. For some reason, it's the moment that I think of as my greatest run.
Wow. I haven't really thought about that before. I mean, I guess because I'm so kind of immersed in the world of the 3100 mile race right now, then and because I just finished doing this race, then I just think of the last 3 hours of the race.
Yeah.
And although I've had many runs in New Zealand in really beautiful places that I would definitely put much higher than running around outwardly than running around a block in Queens. But for me, the last 3 hours of this race, which was just a few days ago, it was kind of at the point where I really felt like the goal is in sight. You know, I mean, most people thought the goal was in sight for days before the race finished, but when you're running it, even though there's only a few days to go, you still know that there's so many things to get through and so many things that could go wrong. But when I was just kind of running along at a regular pace, and then I really had the kind of inner feeling like, I want to finish this race as strong and fast as I possibly can. Like, this is a divine victory. I want this to be like, you know, the best possible finish. And so I just started running as fast as I possibly can. And I just felt so strong and so happy. And I felt everybody's achievement, you know, that all the people who were supporting me and praying for me and helping me, like we were all finishing it together. And it just, you know, especially at this COVID time with so much uncertainty and everything, to be able to have like the certainty of finishing the race and, you know, knowing that that it was a victory for everyone just made me so happy. And to be able to finish it really, you know, really strongly, knowing I felt much stronger than I have in the other two races, and knowing how much joy it would give people, made me so happy. And and then, you know, then having like so many people there at the finish and so many people watching around the world, and I felt like it was a divine victory, and I felt so happy.
Wonderful. Thank you so, so much. We really, really appreciate your time. Thank you so much for this conversation. And once again, congratulations.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so, so much, Harita. That was a great conversation. I did feel hungry in the middle there. All that conversation about that yummy food sounded delicious. Although I imagine when you're 50-odd days deep into a 100-mile race and you're not feeling like eating much, it would take a lot to sound appetizing, but that sure did sound like good food. But anyway, look, thank you everyone for tuning in. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio. Email dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. You can find us on all the podcast platforms. And feel free to like and subscribe if you fancy. And if you can also download direct from the website, which is dirtchurchradio.com. Don't forget to write in with your greatest run ever. We love to hear from you, and you can read them on the website too. Thank you to our sponsors, Scott Running, Further Faster, Cielo, and thank you to our Patreon patrons and Wild Things. And thanks to our editor, Kieran. We've got a great show lined up for next week, so tune in then. Ka kite anō, au ia koutou, e hō mā.
Thanks, Rigby.